Good afternoon, good morning, and good evening. It's Friday, and we're together again from the With the Legacy Changemaker broadcast. My name is Biljana, and I'm here to help you understand what you can do in real life every single day to take action, to help make our planet and make our lives more peaceful, prosperous, hopeful, people and planet-centered. And this is what we do here at Legacy Changemaker. We invite changemakers, and we do not really mind the size of the change, big and small. Each and every change matters, as long as it helps all of us live a more peaceful, prosperous, hopeful, and people and planet-centered life. So welcome, and thank you for being with us. Thank you for giving us your energy, your time. And today, we are celebrating the oceans, because on the 8th of June was World Ocean Day. So on the occasion of the World Ocean Day 2021, we have a very special speaker for you. And we're going to celebrate together the work he and his team are doing. His name is Jean-Christophe Vautrin, right? Yes, he is with us. I can see him. And Jean-Christophe Vautrin, or no one, he prefers to be called JC. He is a seasonal entrepreneur. He's a lecturer. He is an investor. He's a mentor. And of course, he is here, and he is the CEO of the Clean Sea Services. So before I keep on talking, let me invite with us JC Vautrin. JC, are you with us?
Yeah, hi. Nice to see you. Hi to everybody that is joining. I'm very happy to be here and to be your guest. I'm very honored.
Yes, and today, as we know, we're going to talk about there's no planet B, keeping our oceans clean, right?
Yes, absolutely. This is a big challenge because it's part of the ecosystem, and it's a priority for all of us to keep the oceans clean.
Beautiful. So let's start. Let's start with your childhood. Tell us a little bit, where did you grow up and what did you love doing?
So I am a multinational guy by myself. I grew up in close to the sea in Ivory Coast. And then I traveled in many countries, and I really did a lot of things that are related to the sea. I am, for example, scuba diving instructor. I was doing a lot of sailing. So the sea has always been my passion, and I was lucky to meet my first dive with a member of the Cousteau team. You probably heard of Jacques Cousteau, and this passion for the sea never left me. And also later, I was also involved in shipping, and so it has been a very distinguished, special relation between me and the sea.
Great. I remember you telling me that the sea is inside of you.
Absolutely. It's a very nice way to say it. Yes.
Well, those are your words. I'm just offering them again to our audience. We have Desi Dimitrova watching us, who is saying, excited to be here. Thank you, Desi. And we are excited too.
Hi, Desi.
So let's move on. Let's move a little bit, and let's try to find out what is the state of the oceans today.
So unfortunately, the news are not that good. The oceans are very polluted because it has been serving as a damp place for many industry. Then there is overfishing. Then there are many issues, and one of them is that there are many carbon emissions through the shipping industry, and the sea is really a part of our ecosystem and the planet. will survive when we make a real progress of about the sea conditions. And this has been my focus for the last years, is to improve the sea, because with the pollution, there is acidification of the seas, and there are many issues related to the sea.
Let's focus on one of the industries you mentioned. You mentioned the shipping industry. Can you please tell us a little bit more, how does the shipping industry, or how do the ships pollute the oceans?
So, first of all, it's like in every industry, there are really ship owners who pay attention to the cleanliness of the sea, and unfortunately, there are ship owners who don't. And the ones who don't take care of the sea, what they do is they dump a lot of waste into the sea. And the shipping industry is partially responsible for the 6 million tons of oil waste that are put into the ocean every year. Yes, and the issue is that when they dump the waste, most of the waste that they dump in the sea is oil waste, and this oil waste, they contaminate the surface of the sea by increasing the absorption of heat by the sea, and also they constitute this kind of mirror. And you have to know that every ton of oil waste that is dumped into the sea is covering a surface of 12 square kilometers. So year after year, we can soon be at a stage where all the oceans on the planet are going to be covered by this fine particle of oil. And this is also...
And sorry for interrupting you, but I really want to a little bit to unpack what you're saying here for our audience. You were saying that there's a practice of dumping oil in the sea. Where does this oil come from? Can you please explain in very simple words?
It's very simple. On boats, you have engines. Mm-hmm. And these engines, they use, most of them use fuel oil, this heavy fuel oil that is industrial fuel oil. And through operating the sea, the engines are leaking. And the residues that are leaking from the engines, they fall in the bottom of the boat. And they get mixed with the salty water, solid residues, everything that is entering into the boat while the boat is sailing. A boat is not totally waterproof. So at the bottom of the boat, you find this kind of mixture of oil, water, and a few solid residues. And this waste that I call slops, they need to be unloaded from the boat. So they are being put in some tanks first, and then when the boat reaches the port, this waste that is considered as a toxic waste and that's a dangerous waste has to be unloaded and put in treatment in some specialized recycling centers that will split the slops back into fuel oil that can be reused, and the water that needs to be cleaned, and then the solid waste that can be recycled.
Okay, I get it. So I did hear you saying that there are places where these oils are being recycled. Now, can you explain a little bit more, how are the slops dumped into the sea? I want everybody to understand, how does this happen?
So some indelicate ship owners, ship owners that cannot find installations to unload for the slops for treatment, they just pump them out from the boat to the sea.
In the middle of the ocean?
In the middle of the oceans. Obviously in the middle of the oceans, because along the coast, for example, along the European coast, you have a constant surveillance by planes, days and nights, and they have thermic cameras, and they can immediately detect when a boat would dump its oil waste in the sea. But if you go to international waters, or if you sail close to coast, then these countries cannot afford such an expensive surveillance, number one, or some ship owners do reject the waste into international waters where there is no jurisdiction.
Okay, I get it. Thank you for clarifying this. I just want to address our audience, and actually I want to invite our audience also to pose questions. We will be able to see your questions, and we will be able to bring them to on the screen so that JC can answer your questions. So please do not shy, jump in, and tell us what questions you have. So I heard you mentioning some numbers earlier. Can you please repeat the numbers you mentioned?
Yes, they're very scary because mm-hmm. it's year after year. But yearly estimate of oil that ends up in the ocean, and not only from the ship owners, but also, for example, from oil platforms, from boats that are sinking, or the catastrophes, or even oil that is being put in the river, it's about 6 million tons per year. So year after year, 6 million tons of oil products are being unloaded in the oceans. So if you look at what has happened over the last 50 years, you already have 300 million tons of oil products that have been dumped into the sea the last 50 years. As discussed, some shipping industry is only partially responsible for that. The other things being linked to the oil production, the oil rigs, or industrial waste that are produced inland. Because at the end of the day, everything that is produced inland as pollutant ends up in the sea.
Okay, I get it. This is really scary, as you just mentioned. And if we make the calculation, it simply comes down to only 16,500 tons per day, right?
Yes, probably. Yes, this is true.
Yes, this is a sad, sad, sad statistic.
Exactly.
Okay, so let's move on. We kind of discussed, and you explained to our audience what are not so good practices in getting rid of the slops. Now, can you talk a little bit to what are the great practices that are put in place so that the waste in the tanks can be recycled?
So, first of all, it's a combination of best practices and it's a combination of legal factors. Mm-hmm. There are some ports, such as Rotterdam, for example, where you cannot leave the port if you have not emptied what is called the slop tanks. Because these slops, these residues that are collected from the bottom of the boat, they are put in some tanks. So if a boat wants to leave the port of Rotterdam, before they are allowed to leave the port, they have to prove that they have discharged the slops and send them to a collector, so they have been collected by a certified collector, and this collector is in charge of bringing the slops to a recycling center for oil waste. So this is the legal part. When it comes to the best practices, there are some ports where this is not mandatory, but ship owners, the ones that have the good practice, they will willingly discharge the waste into the ports that they are docking in. And then the waste is going to be collected and then recycled into a recycling center. You have to understand that the slops, they have a positive value. So it does not cost anything to the ship owner to treat the slops. It's a break-even operation. Basically, it costs him nothing. So this is why there is not even the financial excuse not to adopt the good practice. You cannot say, I did not recycle my slops because it's expensive, because the slops have a value.
I see. That's great to hear. So what is the change that you and your company is bringing about?
So what we want to offer to the ship owners and to the industry in general is that we are putting and we are developing a concept of a software that would trace both the production of slops on board the vessels and that would trace the elimination of the slops, the fact that the slops are being put into the recycling centers. What do we bring there is that the ship owners, they have a solution, a risk management solution, because one has to understand that if a ship owner, or if a ship is caught dumping this waste into the ocean, the fine can go up to $20 million per event. So you understand that the good practice ship owners, they have no interest in having a dirty image and being associated to ocean crime. So this system is made of sensors in the boat, like the sensors that you have in elevators or in your kitchen. And these sensors, they record a certain number of operations, and all along the process, they exactly calculate what the ship is producing as slops and is measuring. And when the slops are being collected and discharged out of the boat, then there is a sensor that is also measuring the number of tons of slops that are disposed for treatment out of the boat.
You shared with me an image. I would like to share this image with our audience. And would you mind talking or explaining it? Big picture, of course.
Yes, with pleasure.
Okay.
Okay. So, willingly, I have simplified this slide to explain really the activity that I am talking about here in our discussion, and afterwards, if we have some questions, I will be happy to explain what is around this this purple oval. So when you look at the purple oval on the left, you have a loading port, and then you have a ship, and the ship is producing slops. So first, the ship is taking oil on board as a fuel, like you would do, like you would take gasoline for the car. This quantity is measured. Then this quantity of fuel is used for the boat propulsion, so for the boat moving like an engine. And from the combustion of the engines, you have outputs. So what comes in gets out. How does it get out? First, it gets out in form of power. The gasoline that you burn in your car is moving your car. Then it comes out as emissions. The emissions can be CO2, and we see the chimney of the boat, and also the emissions can be oil waste. This oil waste, when we move right from the boat, they are being collected and sent by truck to the recycling center that can be seen on the right hand of this oval. And then from the recycling center, you have three outputs. What do you do with these slops? You produce solid waste that you recycle. You produce water that, once filtered and cleaned, can be put as clean water into the sewage. And you produce oil. You recover about 50% oil of what you discharge as slop, and this oil has a value. So actually, we are in the frame of a circular economy, because the oil that is not used in the boat can be reused, and with being reused, it avoids some more oil to be discovered, extracted, transported, and all this creating CO2 emissions. So basically, what we do, we offer to the ship owners the security of being able to control what's happened in this boat, whether the engines, the emissions, etc. And we participate to the circular economy by avoiding some more fuel needed for other purposes by extracting the fuel that we have from these stops. I hope my explanation is clear.
It's very clear.
I need to be simple. So if people have questions of what is around and what we do with the control, this is another, just to give an idea, and this simple idea is all this data is being collective live from the boat. So it goes through satellites and then it's registered in the blockchain, and you know that in the blockchain's data cannot be tampered. So it's a proof, it's an evidence, it can also be used by the ship owner for insurance purposes, that the ship owner is doing the things properly without putting wastes that are dangerous and toxic into the nature.
Amazing. So, and what impresses me most is that out of the slops that at the moment pollute our oceans, we can produce recycled waste, which is waste which is recycled. We can produce clean water and we can produce more oil, right?
Exactly. So it's like at the same time, so there is a choice for the ship owners, and this is what the governments and the bad ship owners should understand, is that these slops, they have two directions. Either they go and pollute the sea, or they are part of the process of the three R's, reduce, recycle, and reuse, that everybody yes. knows. So we reduce the fuel consumptions because we recover. We reuse because it can be used for other purposes, for cement factories, and we recycle from the recycling plant that is mentioned on the screen.
I heard you saying bad ship owners. Let's leave away a little bit the adjective.
And yeah, sorry for that.
No,
I am too emotional
problem.
About that.
Yes, I understand. But I also think that there's good in each and every one of us. And yes. as long as we try to appeal and to invite the good in us, we are able to really bring about the best of each other. So on that note, what has been the most difficult thing for you and your company as regards the change you're bringing about?
You see, this is a very interesting question, and it joins your precedent comments. And actually, I agree with you. I should not say bad. I should say misinformed. So I think that nobody is willing to do bad. Sometimes people do maybe not the right thing because they don't know that the solution exists to correct that. So there is what was difficult is to make some ship owners understand that there is an alternative. And this alternative is a win-win solution for everybody. So one of the difficult challenge was to get the message through to some ship owners, you know, because it's very difficult to change people's habit. And don't forget one thing is that until our system is in place on the boat, it's very difficult for a ship owner that is based, I don't know, in London or in Singapore to exactly know what's happening on his boat. So there are also things that needs to be explained, controlled. I think that the people that could improve this, they have to be informed, they have to understand what is at stake. And it's not always simple. And there is another issue that is beyond the ship owner's responsibility is that in some countries you don't have such recycling centers. So, you know, I don't think we should be, you know, black and white. I think all this problematic is full of nuances. But we strive to get something that is really making the planet better, but that was as well the local population better, as well the ports better. So in our solution, everybody wins. And I think this is the important point that I want to put forward.
Yes, and of course, Let's not forget the fact that keeping the life beneath and on top of the oceans clean, keeping the life, keeping life on top and underneath the oceans is part of the SDG, one of the SDGs, right?
Absolutely, because we can say life below water, we can also like say life in the water, or we can also say life above the water. Look at all the birds population that live over the water. And also this is a chain effect, because there are a lot of communities that still live from fishing. And I think it is very important that these people have a chance to continue maintaining their lifestyle and not eating toxic fish. So mm-hmm. there is a big challenge regarding the toxicity of fish. And this is very important to try to curve these trends and make people, as I told before, and I'm repeating myself, it's a win-win solution for everybody, because it would be also a win-win solution for the communities that live around the seas, and millions of people live around the seas.
Thankfully, because seas are beautiful places. Dear ship owners, if you're watching us, please consider, what are you doing with your flocks? How are you recycling your flocks? And what are you producing, reusing, and reusing? Please consider. So, for those of you who are not ship owners yet, just like me, JC, what kind of tips would you give us? What can we do?
I think we can already try at a personal level to limit our own emissions. And I think we can also support different projects. So I'm talking about, for example, the project that we develop. I am also very interested in working on the project about the mangroves. So if you are interested to contributing to this project, you can also support organizations, NGOs that work on the mangrove product, because mangrove is also part of the sea life. This is where fish breed, and it's a very important topic for me as well. So there are many things that can be done, and actually, I think the sea activities should really catch up on the land activities and on the sea. Too few things are being done. And I think all of us, we could really at least get knowledgeable of what happens in the sea. And I think when we see what is at stake, I think we're going to be moved and to be concerned and also to be interested in curving all these effects. So we can contribute to some NGOs, organizations, or others.
So, in addition to saving the mangroves, is this the title of the project you're supporting?
Yes, I mean it's. There is the Mangrove Alliance. There is the BOEX platform that is trying to make. A monetization of the carbon credits, because you mangroves trap carbon. So there are many activities that go there. There is a need also for scientific research, so you can support scientific labs that are trying to develop all the programs of saving the mangroves. There are also NGOs that take care of the local community. So there are plenty of things where people can contribute to.
Okay, so just to summarize, two. First of all, find a project that supports and that saves mangroves. And second, if you're a scientist, invest your time, your energy, and your knowledge in researching, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, so what is your last call to action if people would like to support your initiative, the change you are bringing about?
You contact me, and okay. I can really help you or share with you or share your experience. Because you know, in the exchanges there is two ways. So if you are as passionate or even a bit less passionate I am on the topic, please don't hesitate to drop me a line, to give me a call, and we can try to work together. It's a big work. It's there is a lot of things to do. So there is really place for everybody who wants to change the course of things in a positive manner. I am looking at all this process as a positive process. As it comes on my speech on a regular basis, it's win-win. Nobody is losing. Everybody is winning. So the more we are, the faster things will change. And the better it will be for the planet.
Yes. So dear beautiful people out there, dear audience, if you want to support to keep our oceans clean, please get in touch with JC or invest either your money or your energy and time in supporting NGOs and projects that support a clean and beautiful sea or clean and beautiful seas. On that note, thank you very much, JC. It has been a pleasure talking to you. I'm really happy you've managed to explain things so simple so that we, people who do not know a lot about those things, can take action. I wish you all the best. And
thank you very much, Biljana, for inviting me. And I hope really that it's a good source of thought. And thank you for being so patient with me.
You're very welcome. It's my utter pleasure. So, thank you, JC. Dear audience, thank you again. We will see you next Friday. Until then, stay happy and healthy and do take action to make our planet more prosperous, peaceful, hopeful, and people-centered. Thank you and goodbye.